Well, it's the appointed time and we have already found a quorum. Let's invite the administration team to join us. All right, thank you, administration team, for joining us. We have had quite a few meetings already, so I don't think I need to introduce you. According to the House Committee meeting held on the 25th of June, we'll be dealing with two pieces of subsidiary legislation at this meeting. That is LN 102 and LN 103. So the subcommittee has been asked to take on these two pieces of legislation, and in response to these two pieces of legislation, the administration has already submitted the relevant papers to us, and they are tabled before members. They are relating to social distancing measures. So if members do not have other suggestions, we will first have a discussion on the policy issues in relation to those pieces of legislation. First, Mr. Chen Chengying, 5 minutes, please. Thank you. I'd like to look at number 103. It's about religious activities, wedding ceremony, and also business meetings and so on. And if 2/3 of the participants have already been vaccinated, then there'll be a relaxation. And if less than 2/3, then the capacity can also be relaxed to up to 50%, and it's been implemented for some 3 weeks or now. I'd like to know whether or not on such occasions there have been breaches of the relevant legislation, and what's the enforcement figure, and how many activities are covered, and how many of them have been able to meet the 2/3 majority requirement. In other words, 2/3 of the participants have already been vaccinated. And also, in the course of enforcement action, have you found that one person might be using another person's identity according to some extensive media reports? There have been abuse of a situation whereby a person would be using somebody else's identity to take part in such gatherings. So there would be two levels. One would be 2/3 of the participants on site have been vaccinated. So would you be checking each and every one of them in order to find out if they've already met the 2/3 majority requirement? Or would you be asking the operator of the premises to be responsible? Would you be checking their records first before you do the one-on-one check? Or would you just trust the record of the premises without doing the double check? Next, with regard to this relaxation for cinemas and also performance venues and also sports venues and also for the capacity, well, that's been relaxed to 85%, but then for wedding ceremonies, religious activities and so on, well, it's still kept at 50% if less than 2/3 of the qualified persons or the persons have been vaccinated. So when compared to sports venues and so on, so what's the difference between these two types of premises? How come in terms of the percentage there is a difference? So can you explain that? Dr. Choi, thank you. With regard to the enforcement at different premises, I don't have a very detailed breakdown of the figures. In particular, Mr. Chen asked about the new round of amendments and also the breakdowns of the enforcement. Well, I'll have to go back and collate the figures before giving them to you. So my apologies that we don't have the detailed breakdowns today. With regard to the third question, yes, every time when we apply the principle of the vaccine bubble on premises, that's based on the principle that there would be a gradual and progressive approach when it comes to relaxation, and therefore we don't have the stop and go approach. And therefore, by the time when the situation reaches a certain level, then we believe that we can appropriately relax the requirement, and therefore the premises would vary. So we are not going to apply the same sort of approach to each and every premises. Yes, this is a new amendment, and therefore you haven't got the figures. But then according to the media, all right, if you have if you have one card, because everybody can use the same vaccination record. So what about previous inspection? So if participants are required to use the vaccination record as a proof of vaccination, so have you found out that people might be using somebody else's vaccination record, and then they will just download that on their phone and then show it to you? Well, taking enforcement as an action, as an example, just now the honorable member was asking about the vaccination record of the customer. Okay, there are two parts to this. On the one hand, earlier on, as you might recall, at karaoke's, there were media reports about those premises that customers simply did not have the vaccination record, and therefore we took this enforcement action. And there were two customers found at the karaoke without the vaccination record, and therefore we took enforcement action against them, and we issued the fixed penalty ticket to them. So that's one thing. And at the second level, the member was asking, all right, they might be able to show the vaccination certificate or record, but then it doesn't belong to that person, it's somebody else's. But then we will have to deal with that separately, because it's not as simple as, all right, we go in, and then at a certain table, let's say there are 12 people around, and supposedly some two-thirds of them would have to bring with them the vaccination record, but then customers do go in and out of the premises. Let's say when we went in, we saw that there were 8 persons, and then 5 of them had the vaccination record, then there is no reason why we should check that very in great detail, because they could say that 3 had already left, and then 3 plus 5 would mean that they have already exceeded the two-third requirement. But then, all right, if you have 8 people around and then only 5 had the vaccination record, so it's not as clear-cut as we say that, okay, you cannot just come up with a defense saying that 3 had already left. And therefore, sometimes we need to plan our operation. Sometimes you might call that undercover operation. So there are different levels of enforcement. But then with regard to the strategic operational strategy, I don't think I should give you the details, because that would affect our enforcement action. But then I was just trying to give you an example. Okay. I think the director has made it very clear about the enforcement action. But then what I was asking was, in the process of your enforcement, have you found anybody using other people's vaccination record? Let's say if that guy is called Chen Taiman, and then the vaccination record shows that it belongs to Wong Tai Min. Have you found that? Have you found out that? All right, we do have tools available. Well, for the operator, we would give them this apps, and then our enforcement agencies also have our own apps. And in the process of enforcement, we haven't found out that there were cases like what you described, or else we would have taken enforcement action already. Okay, tomorrow, there'll be an oral question. Number 2 is about the Leave Home Safe app, how that can accurately show whether or not you have been vaccinated and so on. That's the reason why I'm asking about the prosecution or enforcement situation. And tomorrow, by the time when the Undersecretary or the Bureau Director comes tomorrow, you would be answering the same question. So if you can bring with you some statistics of enforcement, I think that would be good. Because tomorrow, that oral question would be very similar to those that I just asked. Yes, I'd like to supplement. Well, we haven't seen any case whereby we need to take enforcement action. But then we did conduct inspections. And I'd also like to add that all along, we have been improving or enhancing our arrangements. For example, as you can see, we have already got the apps available. And we have also uploaded the three mobile apps on iOS system and also the Google Play system. And then for the confirmed patients and also what all they need to do is to take one jab. And then under HA Go, they can also use that. So we have been improving those mobile apps in order to ensure that we'd be able to make use of those apps as well. That's the HA Go. Yes, I am I'm in the queue. So how come we are not using this instead of just leave home safe, which shows the vaccination record, so that we can also prevent people from counterfeiting other people's identity and using other people's vaccination records? Well, from the user's perspective, we hope that we can provide as much convenience as possible. Some would just hold with them the physical or the hard copy of the vaccination record, and others would be using iSmart and so on. So long as they can use the mobile apps and then they can scan the record, and then we'll be able to find out if that record is genuine or not. If we require people to use just one mobile app and not the others, then others might not like it, because some might prefer one app to another. Next, Pun Xiuping.
Chair, concerning this subsidiary legislation subcommittee, we've had over 10 meetings already, and I myself do not have a lot of comments on what's on the table, but I just want to ask a question on cap 599F, and that is about cruise ships. And basically this is to protect public health, and that is the operator of cruise ships will have to commit that during the cruise time in the public seas, including when the cruise ship is outside the territorial waters of Hong Kong, that the cruise ships will have to abide by the guidelines and regulations of food and health of Hong Kong. My question is, when the cruise ship is in the open seas, according to my understanding, there is a difference in terms of the jurisdiction of the Hong Kong government over these stretches of waters, as opposed to the cruise ship or a ship being in the Hong Kong waters. And what about the water activities involved? Would that be involved as well? Now, for the gatherings of cruise ships on, that is taking place on the cruise ships, according to my understanding, 599J would be applicable as well. What about catering with food and drink on the cruise ship? That is to say, some 1,000 people or more passengers on the cruise ship, which is very much like a multi-story building. Does it mean that for these passengers and the cruise ship, they will have to follow and abide by the regulations that we are discussing today? And also, recently there had been a variant virus infection of an airport personnel, and the personnel involved was a person handling luggages. My question is, given that infection, does it mean that for imported threats of virus infection, what are some of the recent considerations of the administration in prevention of such infections? Now, if I may just answer the third question first. The FEHD is looking very closely into the case of the involving the airport personnel. We are looking into whether there is any linkage of this case with other previous cases. If we can link up this case with other cases, and we will be able to perhaps find out the network of relationships and or confirmed cases, suspected cases that have gone before. And also, in the past few months, the administration had been continually reviewing the measures, the COVID measures. And also, we want to find out whether on vaccination, whether there are certain benefits that would further attract more people to take the jab. And the scientific panel, the advisors on the panel had said that for the vaccination, those that are vaccinated and returning from certain higher risk areas, perhaps there can be certain relaxation of inbound restrictions. But on the other hand, we have to balance that with the risks concerned. As for cruise ships, I just want to mention that this is a situation that is different from leisure boats in Hong Kong. For leisure boats in Hong Kong, if they are rented out to have parties on the leisure vessels in the territories of the waters of Hong Kong, that's different. It comes under a different set of restrictions from these cruise ships. Chair, if I may just supplement, concerning cruise ships, the facilities on board on the cruise ship will have to follow the CAP 599F scheduled premise restrictions. That is to say, if there is a gym on the cruise ship, then the gym will have to follow all the restrictions that is applicable to gyms operating in Hong Kong. And the difference of cruise ships with leisure boats is that in the definition of leisure vessels or boats, we have also made the distinction. For the definition of cruise ships, we have put in a limb, and that is, it will have to, that is the passengers of the cruise ship, will have to go through important border control measures. So that is one distinction between cruise ships and leisure boats. Chair, my question is then, for restaurants, etc., there are restrictions on the number of patrons. Does it also apply to cruise ships? Yes, it does. And according to CAP 599F, the cruise ships very often have their tracking facilities, such as tokens for their passengers to register their presence in certain parts of the cruise ship, and that is good for tracing and tracking in the future. At the point of boarding the cruise ship, the passengers are asked to scan the Leave Home Safe app. And if the cruise ships can have an installation which can track the presence of the passengers inside the cruise ships, then we do not have to require that each part of the cruise ship will be have to be installed with Leave Home Safe, because they already have that system. Now, the FEHD is not responsible for enforcement on cruise ship. But you're saying that during the cruise ship, there will be government officers on board the cruise ship throughout the cruise? Well, Chair, I don't want to talk about the details of the enforcement. We want the enforcement in the future to be successful. We will have government staff or other staff on board the cruise There are different methods, but we have different ways to see whether the cruise ship operators are following the commitment or contract with the or agreement with the government. That is, when they are in the open seas, whether enforcement is done by the operators. Now, what about the agreement between the government and the cruise ships? Well, according to 599F, when the cruise ship has left the Hong Kong waters, it is no longer applicable. But on the other hand, the cruise ship operators sign an agreement with the Hong Kong government to make the restrictions applicable. And that impacts on whether the cruise ships will be able to operate cruises departing from Hong Kong. We might also slap on certain penalties if there is non-compliance with the agreement. Now, if I may ask a question on cruise ships operating in the open seas. Now, there is relaxation for this kind of operation, and from the tourism industry, we are in support of this. The government's policy is actually very stringent in this regard. Before the ships arrive in Hong Kong, there will have to be 14 days of quarantine beforehand. And also, there will be vaccination and 21 days plus 14 days. So that would be in total 1 month, 3 weeks before the cruise ships can actually welcome passengers on board. And the passengers will have to be all vaccinated, and there will have to be a test beforehand, 48 hours beforehand, and that is very stringent indeed, quite unique. So risks are very, very low. The government, of course, should be rightly concerned, and that is within 48 hours, there should be a negative test result before these passengers can be welcome on the cruise ships. 48 hours is actually very, very stringent. Let's say if the person had done a test the day before and there is a result coming out today afternoon, but then the passenger may then be late with the test results in gaining boarding access to the cruise, because by the time the results are received, it may have exceeded 48 hours. Perhaps 72 hours would be more reasonable. And in this regard, in terms of test results time, can you provide 24 hours more? Because 48 hours can easily be exceeded. And with the very stringent measures, it is almost zero risk at the cruise ships. Given that, can there be some relaxation in terms of the number of days or hours for the certification of a negative test result? And another question, if there are suspected COVID cases after boarding the cruise ship, in the Taiwan situation, I know that is very unique, but there are some false positives cases as well. And in that case, the entire ship will have to return back to Hong Kong because of suspected COVID positive case. And given that, how will you handle the other passengers on the cruise ship? Of course, they will have to come under testing. And if it's negative, they'll be fine. But on the other hand, would these passengers continue to stay on the ship? Or would it be the case that apart from this expected positive case, the other passengers can go back home to wait for test results or wait for the administration of the test itself? This is still open-ended, it seems. As mentioned, whether the sailors or the passengers, they come under this very stringent requirement. And if there can be more specificity on this point, that would be good. And that is it possible for the passengers to go back home to wait for the results, for instance? And then another question concerning the Singapore scenario. They may be the first area or country which will treat the virus as a common flu, for instance, and where the cases do not impact the medical system, they will not be providing public notification of such cases. Now, we are talking about a travel bubble with Singapore. If Singapore claims to have zero case, but in fact it only means that no case affects their medical system locally, given this new policy of notification, will we still consider this travel bubble with Singapore? And I also see the same trend in Europe and the US. They're treating the virus more like an influenza situation. So will there be adjustments on the part of Hong Kong in opening up with them? Or will we be more cautious? Three questions. Now, if I can just answer the third question first, concerning the discussion with Singapore on the travel bubble, because of the COVID situation, it had not been able to commence previously. As the CE had mentioned and others had mentioned, we want to achieve zero cases and also we want to prevent any import of cases. So when discussing travel bubble, we have to be very cautious. In the future, what other specifications will be added in the discussions? At present, we do not have the final decision yet, but definitely we will continue to be cautious in achieving zero positive case.
Second, about how positive cases are dealt with, I'll defer to the DFH. And next is about the testing requirement. Well, we're talking about major cruise activities in one compare to the initial outbreak that took place quite some time ago. Cruises do pose significant risks because of the large number of people on board of the cruise ship. Yes, Dr. Kong. Yes, thank you. If I understand it correctly, that's about the cruise ship. So when people are on board of the vessel and if they have been found positive, then what happens? Well, that would come under the port health authorities of the DFH. And generally speaking, if there are cruise ships entering Hong Kong, and then if they notify us of a suspected case, then the vessel will be designated a moor, and then our DFH colleagues will go up to the, will board the vessel to carry out an investigation. And upon the completion of the investigation, we will then deal with how the passengers should be dealt with and whether or not they should be allowed to leave. Well, recently there were some buildings with confirmed cases, and as a result of that, the entire building would be subject to the restriction testing declaration, and everybody in the building would have to undergo compulsory testing. So can that be done on board of the cruise from the DFH's perspective? Yes, thank you for the question. If we're talking about an incoming cruise ship, then under 599A, with regard to the incoming vessel, there are already provisions concerning how we can deal with that. So the cruise ship will be asked to moor at a particular location, and then our colleagues will go on board of the vessel to carry out the inspection. And then for buildings, it's under another piece of subsidiary legislation under CAP 599. In designated circumstances, if there are suspected cases in a building, then the entire building will be designated or declared as a restriction testing building, and if people there have been tested negative, then they will not be subject to the restriction testing declaration anymore. Yes, I think this pandemic is somewhat different from the other arrangements, and therefore for the cruise liners And the DFH would also have to look at the situation in coming up with relevant regulations so that consumers can be rest assured. And then for the contractors, they know how to deal with that. Once this happens, how they can deal with the situation as regards the aftermath of such cases so that the consumers can be rest assured. You don't have to give us a definitive answer, but then you can discuss with the stakeholders as to how best this can be dealt with. Yes, Undersecretary, Dr. Choi. Yes, thank you. I believe that with regard to the buildings and how that should be dealt with, well, that has taken a process because, we have to analyze the situation and, that's because of the accumulation of experience, and that's the reason why we have now come to this arrangement. But then for cruise ships going to the open sea and then coming back, if there are suspected cases, whether or not that involves the mutant strain and so on. So we will have to look at how the situation develops. And what about the 48-hour requirement? So is it Ms. Chen who will supplement? Yes, after all, we have just started to allow for this CTN or CTP, CTN itineraries. So we will see how it goes and then see how the situation develops before we discuss with the Tourism Commission as to how that can be further fine-tuned. Okay, please be as expeditious as possible. If everything works out well, then why don't you just relax the requirement? Because you're just talking about the tightening up or relaxation of it by some 24 hours. Yes, Mr. Lok Chong Hong, number one, I support the proposal. Second, it's about religious activities. Okay, if you've taken the first jab and if two-thirds of the people have done so, then there can be a relaxation. So for the religious bodies, that would be a help because for churches, temples, and religious premises, they would be thrilled because initially they were not allowed to hold so many persons under their roof, and that's the reason why they have not been able to arrange for certain events. So through some religious bodies, have you asked them to encourage their followers to take the jab? Because for followers of religions, they would be more willing to listen to their religious heads than the government. So can you encourage the religious leaders to come forward to encourage people to take the jab? I don't think taking the jab would have anything to do with their religion or be of anything against their religious beliefs. Okay. Relaxing the restrictions is something good because we can see that the pandemic situation has eased already. And then for sports premises, apparently there haven't been major relaxations. When can you introduce more relaxations? For example, there have been a lot of calls for indoor sports venues so that for people who have taken both jabs, do they still have to wear a mask when they exercise? Because that would affect the business of many premises because according to some coaches, there are no longer trainees, even if they continue to open for business. Because for indoor sports activities, basketballs, whatever, if you have to do exercise or exercise while you have the mask on, it's really hard. So when will the situation be ripe for them to relax the rules so that people do not have to wear a mask when they exercise? Thank you. Well, with regard to religious activities, well, through various policy bureaus, we've been liaising closely with the religious groups, and they've been asked to contact their stakeholders so that in the next round of relaxation, there is room for further relaxation and then for religious groups. Overall speaking, through the HAB, we have been in contact with them. But then I agree with what you just suggested. That is, religious groups can also make use of their the influence of their leaders so that they can also contact their followers and Therefore, if there can be further relaxation up to 100% if everybody has been vaccinated, then that's good. So through their publicity, I hope that that will help. And also for sports events, according to the latest announcement, one is about indoor sports venues. If they continue to operate and if all the staff and also all the users of that part of the premises have been vaccinated, and on top of that, the staff will also have their vaccination records available, then when people exercise in those premises, they are not required to wear a mask. So we've been reviewing the situation constantly, and where there is room for relaxation, we will do so. Next, Mr. Lok Chong Hong, for sports premises, if you require everybody to be vaccinated, it's somewhat hard because so long as there are a handful of odd fish, then you will not be able to meet the 100% requirement. So if you set the threshold at 70%, for example, so if 70% of the users have already been vaccinated, then you can afford not to have them all wear a mask, or else for the coaches and also for the sports premises, they are still operating in great difficulty because it's hard to wear a mask when you exercise. So they are very much a disaster zone after what happened. So can you review the situation? For example, for the basketball league, we haven't resumed the activity yet. Earlier on, they did have some matches, but then it's hard to have a high quality match when you have to have your mask on. Okay, so can you consider further relaxing the rule? Okay. Yes, Ms. Chen. Yes, Mr. Lok referred to some league matches and so on. Well, we are aware of that. That's why in the second stage of the vaccine bubble arrangement, well, for sports premises, it's hard to require everybody in the premises to be vaccinated. That's the reason why we are using part as the threshold. For example, for people playing basketball in the basketball court, if everybody has been vaccinated, and also for the staff working in that area, if they have also been vaccinated, then the no mask rule will apply. But then, as you might recall earlier on, we did have a fitness center where there was an outbreak, and therefore we have to be more cautious. That's the reason why we asked that all users should be masked if they haven't been vaccinated. Thank you. Next, Xiu Ka-fai. Thank you, Chairman. I'd just like to know, well, recently there were three cases whereby two were working at the airport. One was found out while he was staying in the quarantine hotel. And for the three cases involving the airport, he said that he had the first jab 9 days before he was diagnosed. But then what about the other two? Have they been vaccinated as far as you are aware? Well, can you answer the question first? Dr. Choi? Sorry, Chairman. I don't have the information with me right now. Mr. Xiu? You said that you were suggesting that the other two had not been vaccinated. All right, there were three recent cases, and for the latest one, well, 9 days before he was confirmed positive, he already had the first jab. So what about the other two? There was no announcement whatsoever. So had they taken the two jabs already, or what? And also, according to the administration, all right, the pandemic has been with us since February last year. That was 2020, so it's more than a year now. And Hong Kong has been having this stop-and-go situation, and recently, for more than 30 days in a row, we hadn't had any infection at all. And just yesterday, we had a case, and people have made a lot of sacrifices. And now the situation is easing off. But then every time when we heard that there's an imported case in the community, in particular for premises that have to stop or suspend their business, everybody will be very worried and concerned because their livelihood would be affected. And then for people coming or arriving in Hong Kong while they're staying at the quarantine hotel or while they are at the airport, inevitably they have to be allowed in. They have to come in. But then at that point, those places would be of high risk. So for those high risk premises, if the colleagues or users, if they are able to go in and out of those places, in fact, for people arriving in Hong Kong, of course, they would have to go to the quarantine hotel for 14 days. And then if they have not been found to have been infected, then they would be allowed back into the community. But then for the people working there, like the cleaning workers, the cargo workers and so on, all right, they are Hong Kong residents. So is there a requirement for them to take both jabs, and also they have been vaccinated for more than 14 days before they'd be allowed to work there? Do we have such a guideline? Dr. Choi.
Thank you, Chairman.
With regard to the cases at the airport, according to our analysis, we would track every case to find out the workflow and where they had been in order to make improvements. So where there is room for improvement, we will not hesitate to do it in order to plug the loophole. Next is about vaccination. The government does not have a mandatory requirement for a particular type of jobs whereby all the people working in those trades would have to be vaccinated. For example, we do not have a mandatory requirement for people to be vaccinated, or else they will have to be subject to the biweekly test.
Chair, I just want to say that this is really unacceptable. If this is your stance and that of the airport authority, then the Hong Kong people, having done so well for so long, will come to naught. Because this is about imported cases, the hotel is one gate, and then the airport is another. Every day, in fact, Hong Kong people are going into these high-risk areas. And if, let's say, they are cleaners of hotel rooms of these quarantined persons, then they may bring out the viruses to the community. Now, apart from PPE that they don, they should also take the two jabs and also develop antibodies. Now, you're saying that there may be certain persons who are not suitable for taking the vaccination, then they can do regular testing. Well, if there are such people, I plead with them not to go into these areas. Let's say he's an aged person and he does not have antibodies, and please do not work in such areas. Please ask them to work elsewhere. Do not bring this upon the Hong Kong community. And you do not put that person in risk as well. So we see three cases coming in from these gateways. Of course, for the quarantined, they will not be bringing the viruses into the community because they are under quarantine. But those who are working closely among them and in those areas, they are bringing the virus into the community. Not just the jabs for them, but also they have to have developed the antibodies. Have you ever thought about that? Well, Chair, thank you for the suggestion. In reviewing every case and also the flow of each case, this is something that we have to undertake. And definitely the government will talk to the airport authority in terms of the division of work. If a worker does not have sufficient protection, then there should be special arrangement at the airport area to lower infection risks. Yes, please. Please, for those who cannot take the jab or do not take the jab, please ask them not to work in those areas. All right, please bring that back to the relevant people. Now, As for the other question, do you have the data on hand? No, we do not have the data on hand. Right. Basically, Mr. Xu's point is to minimize the risk by having the relevant persons take the jabs. Right. Ms. Kwok? Chair, I think the world trend is changing as we speak. Our motherland and the UK, the US, and we see more and more vaccination. By the time it reaches 80%, 90%, it will be completely open in terms of society. And for those who are infected, it seems that for those vaccinated, they would not develop very serious symptoms and they will not completely disrupt the health system. So it would be like a flu. And because the countries can protect the lives of their citizens, therefore they can afford to open up almost entirely. Now, for Hong Kong, I think we have to speed up with the vaccination rollout process as soon as possible. This is of urgent need. If we can all in Hong Kong undergo vaccination, then we can, like these other countries, also open up more of our economy and society so that our everyday life can be more normal in Hong Kong, and most importantly, that there can be border crossings again. So I'm very anxious about imported virus cases, as Mr. Xu had mentioned just now, for the high-risk areas such as the airport. For those who are in the front line working at the airport, if they are not well protected, as in being vaccinated and also undergo regular testing, for instance, and they bring the virus into the community causing infections in the community, then whatever we do in the community, vaccinate, etc., will come to naught. And it's in today's news as well. France is already saying that for frontline medical staff, and they will have to be vaccinated without exception. But I think there will have to be certain exceptions if there are certain physical conditions or physiological conditions. And they also say that there will be a rollout of health passport, whether it be patronizing restaurants and going on planes, there will have to be show of this passport. Greece as well are asking frontline medical staff, etc., to complete the vaccination. I also think that for high-risk workers in Hong Kong, whether they are HA or airport authority or old age home staff, they will all have to be vaccinated. Otherwise, they not only cannot protect themselves, but they also expose others in Hong Kong to risks. So this has to be done. And the other countries are also saying that without vaccination, they cannot go to school, because this is not just about protecting oneself, but also protecting other students and teachers. And I believe that this is the mega trend in the world. Hong Kong will have to be in the forefront of this, because we have been plagued by the COVID-19 for so long. We yearn for normal life. And it's not because of their failure that there's been cases. There had been infections affecting the community, and therefore the border had been closed, etc. And so I would like the administration to be a lot more proactive. And for instance, the civil service should all be vaccinated as well. If they choose not to be vaccinated, they do not need to come to work then. Now, as for the vaccines, we, of course, have the certification, the QR code, and I think we can improve on that as well. As I've mentioned in the previous meeting, some people can actually scan their other people's vaccination certificate or record onto their own app. And they go into restaurants, etc., as though they themselves have been vaccinated. So what are you going to do in this regard? How can you verify that the person who shows the vaccination record is indeed the holder of that vaccination record, bona fide person. Chair, concerning vaccination, the government is very concerned about that. If we look at recent numbers of vaccination, it has risen. Last year, it was 61,000 persons vaccinated, and over 2.7 million in Hong Kong had already been given the first jab. So this is relatively optimistic. As for the electronic platform in recording vaccination, the IT office of the government already has certain studies in providing a platform for, let's say, restaurants in Hong Kong to develop a better record system as well in Macau. Now, we also see, Chair, that some 70 universities are requiring vaccination records before there can be going to school. That is to say, for frontline staff in the universities, they should all be vaccinated. There should be such a requirement in Hong Kong as well. We've said this many times. In the education panel, we've asked the Secretary of Education, and he says that he needs your department for clear guidance. It seems that you're passing the ball around. Can you be more decisive? You are a disease control frontline department. Can you be more decisive? Will you require students and staff and teachers to be vaccinated for the universities, for instance? Otherwise, everybody will be waiting and waiting. I believe the universities will have their own measures in lowering risks with increased in vaccinations, such as in the residential halls of the universities. And in the future, in the resumption of school, we will be giving advice to the education department, including policies concerning vaccination requirements. Chair, it seems that they're passing the ball around without any department wanting to be decisive, and the Hong Kong people are in a very passive position and interminably waiting. Go back and think about this. Yes, I think you have heard the very clear comments and suggestions of Ms. Xu and Ms. Kwok. Please go back and think of a very clear policy for vaccination for all. Oh Chong-Xing, Chair, I would want to express my high degree of concern in this regard. I agree with my colleagues in saying that the FHD will have to be a lot more decisive in coming up with stringent measures. And I want to say that the citizens of Hong Kong are very cooperative. They want to be cooperative with all the measures of the government. For the buildings lockdown, which was controversial, but in fact, the people of Hong Kong are now very accepting of it. Please focus on combating COVID and focus on resuming normal life, whether it is social or economic. It's been 2 years. Can we improve on the policies? Can there be more stronger policies? Education is a problem. Medical is a problem. I see a lot of colleagues in the HA who are not vaccinated. And how do we encourage people in Hong Kong to be vaccinated when we see that they fall short of the vaccination request? So, and you're not able to, Dr. Choi, tell us what your problems are. What are your problems? Why can't you just go full steam ahead with vaccination in Hong Kong? What are the problems? If you're so laissez-faire, then I really don't know how long this COVID situation will be plaguing Hong Kong for. I mean, we are getting very good statistics recently. nearing zero cases, take this opportunity. Now, and another question I would like to ask, and that is the the circuit breaker. I would like to know, and a lot of people ask this question, and that is the circuit breaker policy. Can you improve on that? And that is to put more emphasis and resources on that. All right, two questions. First of all, what are your problems? Well, first of all, if I can respond on the vaccination policy, of course, the government is putting a lot of efforts in encouraging vaccination. And it's just been mentioned by Mr. Orr that for the HA vaccination, doctors are vaccinated by 80% and nurses 40 to 50%, and the trend is going up. And there are some internal HA measures encouraging staff to be vaccinated. And a second point, even though there is no mandatory vaccination policy rolled out by the government, but we do encourage vaccination. As members had mentioned just now, at the work level, there can be arrangement for staff to have the right arrangement, whether according to whether they are vaccinated or not. And also, the health department had been making it more stringent in terms of circuit breakers concerning incoming or inbound flights. And yesterday, we came up with a notice where Russia is now categorized as A2, high risks. So that goes to show we continue to be very much on the ball with regard to the developments around the world where an area is high risk. We will put in the measures to avoid cases in being imported to Hong Kong.
Well, I cannot accept your explanation because many Hong Kong people would expect that they should be able to show their smile by taking off their mask. But then the thing is how the administration is able to do this. Can you just rely on encouragement and also the issuance of guidelines and so on? Apparently, it's not enough because if you look at the number of vaccinations daily, yes, the administration has been doing what it should, and there have been a lot of incentives provided by different businessmen and so on. But then the administration will have to go back and think about this. This is not the first time that we bring this up. On different occasions in the past, we have already asked the administration to do better. Instead of just telling us what you said earlier, I don't think it's acceptable. So you will have to go back and think about it. So this is a very pressing issue. You will have to come up with some measures in advance, or else once we have another wave of outbreak, then that will be very disappointing to the public, okay? I think the appeal is very clear. So please go back and think about it. So we can have a phased approach to require people to take the jab. Only if that is only when that is done will we be able to have a herd immunity in a community. If you just try to do it by way of encouragement, incentives through the business sector and so on, I don't think that will work. Because I think the vaccination rate has almost plateaued now. Okay, Mr. Pun Xiuping, 4 minutes. Yes, it's been more than a year since we had the pandemic, and everybody would like to restore to some form of normalcy. And the chief executive said that she'd be submitting a report to the central authorities, and she would also encourage people to take the jabs in order to reopen the border between Hong Kong and the mainland. So, can they do something to achieve a better result? I don't know. But then, as a member of the public, that's our common hope. I'd just like to say something about the CT and Cruise to Nowhere itineraries. Yes, you told us something about this. But then, I'd just like to know, Okay, you have already come up with the subsidiary legislation. And also for the cruise liners, how many are there which is willing to sign the undertaking with you? And when will they really be able to introduce the CTN itineraries? And second, about CAP 599F, about the food establishments or the catering establishments, there are already some relief measures. But what about bathhouses? There have been some relaxation already. But then what about sauna rooms? Apparently, they are still not allowed to reopen. What are the reasons? And what if people have already taken the jabs? Can they use the sauna rooms? So can you tell us more about those? Yes, first question, Ms. Chen. Ms. Chen? Yes, Alan Chen. Yes, we've been working closely with two cruise liners to introduce CTN itineraries. For one, getting closer to closing the deal. So that will become the first company to introduce the CTN itinerary. So they've already signed the undertaking. Yes. Dr. Choi, I'll defer to Ms. Wong. Yes, Ms. Wong. With regard to sauna rooms and bathhouses, we have already relaxed the rule. Well, just now, for sauna rooms, can you speak up a bit? Well, for sauna rooms or bathhouses, we have already talked to the traders with regard to the business hours and also the social distancing measures and so on. And for the issue that the Honourable Member just referred to, with regard to the sauna rooms within the bathhouses, there are other premises where there are shower and sauna facilities. There is no distinction between the two. So according to some people, well, in some hotels and also some clubhouses, the sauna rooms are not open. So even if you have already taken both jabs, are there scientific data or evidence to say that, taking a shower is not a problem at all. But then what about sauna rooms for people who have taken the jabs? Why can't they use the sauna rooms? Well, Chairman, let me supplement. According to my recollection, during the initial outbreak, if there are aerosols, then that would also help spread the disease. And that's the reason why we try as possible to make sure that nobody or such aerosols will not be generated in the course of some business activities. That's the reason why we have to be more cautious. Yes, Ms. Chen, you have something to add? Yes, as the Undersecretary just said, so I have nothing further to add. Okay, Mr. Lok Chong Hong. Thank you, Chairman. Well, for some prevention measures, I think that has to do with the vaccination rate. I think the biggest hope of the community is to reopen our border. Recently, there has been a hike in the number of vaccinations, over 60,000 a day. But then, to achieve the target of 80% for the 1.4 billion people in China, I think we are still quite a far cry from that. There are many factors affecting the vaccination rate. So I'd like to refer to this. I think the problem is the administration will have to set a timetable as well as a roadmap, because without those, as to whether or not you're able to achieve a certain milestone by a particular timeline, then you will have to adopt the carrot and stick approach. Or else, if you just adopt a laissez-faire approach by encouraging people to take the jab. Yes, Undersecretary, I know you've been working very hard, but then however hard you try, without the sticks, people will simply not be prepared to take the jab. Well, the incentives might be good, but then they can also be counterproductive. Recently, I received a complaint. Well, in the housing department, Well, I'd also like to check with you because there might be similar problems with regard to other departments. Okay, there's an outsourced contractor of the housing department. Well, they received this notice that is for staff who have taken the jab, so they can enjoy this vaccine holiday. Okay, that's a very good thing. So long as they take the jab after a certain date in July, then they can also take a day off after the their vaccination. So one day off per jab. That's very good. But then the problem was, for those who had taken the jabs before that date, they would not be entitled to taking the compensation day off. So what is going to happen? Then people will say that I'll wait because I might be able to get some incentives later. Well, that has to do with the average bureau, okay? I'm saying that this is a good policy. But then you should have done it earlier. Well, for civil servants, they can also take a compensation day off. But then for outsourced contractors, they could also do the same if the same principle applies. Because on the one hand, you have to adopt the stick approach. But you should have a timetable. So even if you're not able to make it a mandatory requirement, what about civil servants? At least they are working at the front line, so to require them to take the jabs is reasonable, unless they can have a doctor's certificate saying that they are not suited, that it's not suitable for them to take the jab. Otherwise, there is no justifiable grounds for them not to take the jab, because they are after all serving the community. I think several members have asked the same question. So can you briefly respond to that? Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to thank the Honourable Member for his question, as some others have suggested too. In terms of our vaccination policy, we will have to work doubly hard. So we will go back and think about it. And then for vaccine holiday, the administration has taken the initiative by introducing it in the civil service system. And of course, we'd like the other employers to follow our footstep. Yes, Xu Kafai. Thank you, Chairman. In response to what Mr. Pun Xiuping just said, he was concerned about the sauna room situation. I'd just like to say a few words because the Undersecretary also helped us so that for sauna rooms, they can also resume business. My understanding is that for sauna rooms, okay, those are the massage parlors and bathhouses, and also there are dry sauna rooms and wet sauna rooms. You said that you were concerned about the generation of aerosols. That's the reason why they have remained closed. But then many of those companies have already reopened for business, even though they might not be able to resume 100% of their business. But then once again, I'd like to thank you for your help, or else if you just adopt the across-the-board approach, then they would be seriously affected. But then, will you be permitting them to reopen their baths, pools, or bathtub, or the steam rooms, and so on? So you can also make reference to the experience elsewhere. And then, once again, I'd like to ask you this. I heard the CE said yesterday, well, she'd be preparing a report for submission to the state authorities to ask if there can be partial reopening of the border. So according to your understanding, what does that mean? Because that the border has been closed for quite a while. And according to the traders, well, even for me, I am in the wholesale and retail sector. Many of my counterparties would like to come to Hong Kong again. But then they are also concerned about the health of the people here in Hong Kong, and if you can have a partial reopening, that would be good. Or else we cannot just have lockdowns everywhere all the time. But then for the people coming here, they have to have the two jabs, and it has to be more than 14 days. You would also have to not just test their PCR, but also their antibodies before they would be allowed in. And then we would also be concerned about who should be given priority for people who come here for family reunion, because there are families that have not seen one another for a long while. And also for people who have business on the mainland for more than a year, they have not been able to go back to check on their business. And also for tourists, if they've already taken the jabs, then allowing them in for sightseeing purposes would also be a good thing for our business sector. So can those be done? Undersecretary, I haven't got the details of this report. And if we look at previous experience, for example, we have the return to Hong Kong scheme or come to Hong Kong scheme. Well, if you look at the quota and also where it can be implemented and also the vaccination requirement and also the corresponding arrangements and also the personal needs or business needs and so on, well, those would be some of the considerations. Yes, Ms. Wong, do you have anything to add with regard to the premises? No. I'd just like to add this. On this occasion, okay, for partial reopening of the border with the mainland, well, earlier on, you had the return to Hong Kong and some 100,000 people came back to Hong Kong via that scheme, and the risk was very low or next to zero. So you can tell the central authorities, I think they have done a remarkable job in containing the disease, but then worldwide people might not be able to understand that. So does that mean that we can only reopen our border when the infection rate was zero? It might take several years if that is the case. So even if we do not target at zero infection, so long as there are only isolated cases, I think it's still a very good thing to try out. We can also do it at some pilot points. Yes, my question is similar to Mr. Xu's question. That is about reopening the border. Okay, over the past month or so, we have done a remarkable job, but then from time to time there might be isolated cases, and then you will have to track the cases to see if there has been any spread. But then subsequently we found out that invariably is the only case. So we have done a remarkable job, but then because of the isolated cases, we have not been able to reopen our border with the mainland and Macau. And some overseas countries would like to reopen the border with us, but then we would be very cautious about this. So can you discuss or negotiate with the mainland authorities as to whether or not there can be a circuit breaker mechanism, for example, for a week or so, if there are only a couple of cases and there has been no further spread, then we can reopen the border until and unless there is a circuit breaker. For example, if there are more than three cases, for example, then we will close the border again.
And even if you can open the border, let's say on the 10th day there is a new case, what then? Do we then close the border again? What do you do? So, of course, we may not have an answer today at this meeting, and we may not have the discussions with the mainland today. But on the other hand, I think this is a direction that you should take. You can raise this as a possibility and set certain mechanisms. And that is, for Hong Kong, if we put into place whatever mechanisms and put in place certain measures, then we will continue to do so. Where the number of cases are at a certain level and over which or under which we will be putting in certain measures, for example, circuit breaker. So if you can do this in your discussion with the mainland, can you do that in your discussion with the mainland? Well, thank you for the suggestion. I'm sure the CE will try her very best to relay some of the success points in our combat of COVID in the past. I do not have the details, but definitely this will be. There is room for such discussions, I believe. And at present, there can be no special announcement in this regard, but we thank the members for the opinions. Now, for these two subsidiary legislation. If you have no further comments, we go clause by clause now. Now, if you can refer to the clause-by-clause document provided by the administration. Thank you, Chair. First of all, LN 102, and that is number 3, Regulation 2021, Prevention and Control of Disease. And it is in Schedule 2. And we have added cruise ships. And so this is with regard to the resumption of operation of cruise ships. The second amendment is in definition. In definition, we have put in the definition for cruise ships. And these are basically for cruise ships which are, yes, the definition of cruise ships carrying passengers exclusively for sightseeing or pleasure purpose, or plying along a predetermined route, or the boarding of which involves passage through immigration control. You've explained that, right? Yes, for cruise ships leaving the waters of Hong Kong, they do not go through the immigration checkpoints of Hong Kong, so they may not fall into this definition, and that's why we have come up with this amendment. All right, the next one, 599G next. And that is LN 103, 2021, Prevention and Control of Disease, Prohibition on Group Gathering, Amendment number 4. The first amendment is in number 2, definition, interpretation, and that is qualified person. We have amended the definition because we want this to be clear, and that is the head of FEHD in coming with up with the conditions of qualified persons. If certain persons have already reached the qualification, we want to specify these as qualified persons. It means a person who meets any set of conditions specified under Section 5B1. And then for 5A, we have added one more point, and that is Schedule 1, Line 20. And this is the groups, that is tour groups involving over 100 participants. And next amendment, 5B. 5B, we have included a new 1A, and as mentioned just now, this is to say that without limiting subsection 1F, the secretary may specify condition under subsection 1 by reference to whether a certain proportion of persons participating in the group gathering concerned has met any other condition specified under the subsection 1. The next amendment is in number 7, that is defense for offense under section 6, and under that, there is a bracket 3, the interpretation there. And that is, for ease of reference, apart from the 3 existing conditions, we have added item 20 of part 1 of Schedule 1 relates to certain tours, and that is tours involving more than 100 participants. The next amendment is in Cap 559, sub-legislation G. Section 9. 9A, First Amendment. Originally, it exempts for gatherings of no more than 20 persons. And for this amendment, apart from weddings without food and drink being served, we have increased the number of permissible size of gathering to the number of participants in the gathering is restricted to not more than 50% of the number of persons that may normally be accommodated on the premises as a place for wedding ceremony. And further, we do not distinguish between indoor and outdoors for the number of participants, as long as the participants are qualified persons. And that is the new 9B C. The number of participants in the gathering is restricted to not more than 100% of the number of persons that may normally be accommodated on the premises as a place for wedding ceremony. Section 11, and that is there cannot be more than 20 persons in each of the separated parts of the rooms. We're now amending it to restricted to no more than 50% of the number of persons normally accommodated on the premises as a place of meeting. For 11AC, the amendment is the number of participants in the gathering is restricted to not more than 100% of the number of persons that may normally be accommodated on the premises as a place of meeting. And next, the amendment is in section 18, not more than 100% of the number of persons that may normally be accommodated on the premise as a place of worship. It was 30% before. And also for section 17, going back, we have increased by 20%. The number of participants in the activity being restricted is not more than 30% of the number of persons that may be in the place of worship that was before, and now we've added 20% to 50%. Next amendment, 20. Group gathering of not more than 100%. The tours, as mentioned, is increased to 100 persons participating. My question is, now 100 participants for one tour, that is fine. What about it is divided into tours A, B, and C? Would that be 300 people then? We're talking about gathering of persons. And for gathering of persons, there would be organizers for such gatherings, and also there would be itineraries for each tour. So we will look upon a tour as an entity. And if it is a separation of the same tour, we will have to look at the itineraries, whether they are the same or overlapping, or there will be commingling of participants in among the three tours that you've mentioned. So we will have to look into the cases themselves. The next amendment, in the same schedule, part two, interpretation for weddings and certain meetings and gatherings for worship, we have not distinguished whether these are indoor or out-of-door venues. And therefore, for the definition for indoor and outdoors, we have deleted the interpretation of that here. So those are the amendments for you. Well, thank you very much. Our legal advisor, anything from you? Yes, I've looked at the Chinese and English versions. They are in alignment with each other. There are no other comments. We go into AOB. Yes, concerning the timing, and that is tomorrow, we will be providing a motion and the extension for the passing of the sub-legislation will be extended to the 5th of August at the LegCo. And then at August 11th will be the deadline for the actual announcement of the preview. And according to our ordinary procedure, before the deadline for the there will be our verbal report to the House Committee by the 16th of July concerning the deliberations of our meeting at our meeting on these sub-legislations. Anything else, our next meeting? No, there is none on our plate for the for any other sub-legislation discussion. So no next meeting date. End of meeting here. Thank you.